Hey, brothers and sisters, I want to make another video, and I wanted to talk about how to be blessed. Many people do have financial troubles, brothers and sisters, and I want to talk about that. You know, the prosperity gospel people have really got things way out of balance. You know, most of you guys who watch this video, you know that's true. You know, it's just like the greasy gracers, people that believe you can say the sinner's prayer when you're 10 years old, live like the devil all your life and go to heaven, and are out of balance. And people that believe that if you're not perfect and you make one mistake, you lose your salvation every 5 minutes if you have a wrong thought. Those people are out of balance. You know, and the same thing is true about money. People are out of balance about, you know, the fact that God blesses us. I want to read a few Bible verses to you and let it speak for itself. Now, let me read what the Lord said in the Old Testament. Another thing, too, that people keep talking about, whenever we give, in the Old Testament, they use the guide of tithing, which is 10%. Whatever we give unto the Lord. And it's also true in the text, in the Old Testament, it's talking about giving a tenth of your stuff, like your wheat and all that, to the priest in the temple in Jerusalem. Now, of course, we don't give to the temple in Jerusalem, and lots of people, you know, are not farmers today, you know, since World War II or so. The vast, vast majority of people are not farmers anymore. So I've heard people say wacky stuff like, well, you're supposed to give your vegetables and stuff to the church. You don't give money. Well, you know, that's the form of currency they had. If you're a farmer and you've got, 100 tons of wheat, that's your currency, and you convert it to the currency that everybody else uses, you know, dollars if you're in America or whatever is the currency in your country, you know, that it's the same thing. So we should give, and 10% is a good guide. Do we have to tithe? Are we under the law where we tithe? No. It's just like everything else with the Lord. In the Old Testament, Jesus said, you've heard it's been said, do not commit adultery. But I say unto you, if you look on a woman with lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. Jesus uses that with lots of the Ten Commandments. So, of course, tithing is not one of the Ten Commandments. But, you know, under the law, it's not about giving 10%. Because in the Old Testament, boom, you don't commit adultery. Check, I didn't do that. Buddy, you kept looking on women at lust. You know, you keep looking at pornography, but you didn't commit adultery physically, literally. So you think you're good to go. Jesus is saying no. So when you talk about tithing in the Old Testament, say, well, you know, I gave my 10%. I got my ticket punched. No. You give as the Lord leads you, whether it be 20% or 8% or whatever. You know, you give. The 10% is a guide. You give as the Lord leads you, you know. And then the Bible says in the New Testament, God loves a cheerful giver. So in the Old Testament, you give your 10%, you're muttering and complaining and having, you know, and talking junk to yourself and murmuring that, you know, that you don't want to give 10%. The law says give 10%. You did it. You didn't commit adultery. Good. In the New Testament, God judges the thoughts and intents of your heart. So it's a whole lot higher standard. It's not a lower standard. It's a higher standard. So let's look at this text. Two different texts. I want to look. One from the Old Testament, one from the New. Malachi 3:10. But, you know, in 3:9, you know, 3:8, Malachi 3:8, it says, will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? And then in tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Now, that's under the law. But us, we've been redeemed from the curse of the law. But let's don't talk about, you know, people get it backwards. It's like if I sin, God's going to be mad at me. Instead of saying, if I walk in God's will, he'll bless me. He'll be pleased with me. So let's look at it from the positive side. Instead of all these negative, you know, wowsy, wowsy, woo-woo, you know, slap rock people. Let's look at it from the positive. You know, God will bless you. God loves a cheerful giver. I'm going to look at a New Testament text of what Jesus said from Luke chapter 6 in a minute. God blesses you when you're obedient. And giving is one of them. And it's one of the biggest ones that people have trouble with. That's why people don't want to talk. Oh, those prosperity preachers. Oh, you know, the truth is most people are not using that because, these preachers on TV, whoever you're talking about, Kenneth Copeland or whatever, they got a private jet and all this flying around. Okay. Don't use that as an excuse for you not giving unto the kingdom of God. You know, don't use that as your excuse to justify you having money as your God. And that's what most people are doing. You know, the average guy walking down the street, Kenneth Copeland's going to answer to God. Those people that gave to him, they know he's got a jet. They're going to have to answer to God if they're giving to him and it's not being used properly for the kingdom of God. He has to give an account. They have to give an account. Not being good stewards of God's money. What does that got to do with you of justifying yourself by not, you know, giving as the Lord would have us do? Let's keep reading here. Bring verse 10. Malachi 3:10. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. He's talking about feeding the priest there in the temple. But it applies to us too. He's talking about like feeding the orphans in the Philippines, feeding the feeding programs we do, and all the other ministries that people do. His brother Dave Hung up there, he has he feeds homeless people in Detroit, whatever. You know, whatever. In the name of Jesus. Anything done in the name of the Lord is part of the kingdom of God. If I feed the homeless people and I tell them nothing about the gospel and tell them, oh, I'm great and I'm giving you this food. No, that's not for the Lord. But if I give them the food and say, hey, you know, this is the gospel, Jesus, John 3:16 and all that. Okay, I'm doing it in the name of the Lord. It's part of the kingdom of God. You can give your tithes to Pastor Dave to do the feeding the homeless people in Detroit. As long as he's evangelizing them and trying to disciple them and ministering, doing it in the name of the Lord, it's part of the kingdom of God. It's not a physical building. You know, this. We don't have a temple like in Jerusalem. You know, the original church in the book of Acts met in people's houses. There's no official, you know, that's some, you know, Roman Catholicism stuff. Jesus born in a manger. Let's keep going. See, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me, test me. Now, wherewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that you shall not have room enough to receive. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. I'll stop the enemy from attacking you. And he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. Not just talking about, oh, it's just, that's for farmers. No, you know, think and translate that into your life. You know, your job, your finances, that your car won't break down, all that, whatever, you know, those kind of things. And he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. And all the nations shall call you blessed. Okay? And you go on and on. We can apply that to us too. Let's see what the Lord says in the New Testament. I want to keep moving here. You know me. Let's see. 6:38. I don't believe it. See, Jesus is talking about, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Pressed down and shaken together and running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure you meet withal, it shall be measured back to you. Another, that's Luke 6:38. Jesus talked. There's another verse in there. It says, Jesus says, with the same measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. That's what was in the text I just read. anyway, brothers and sisters, so with the way we give, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly, the Bible tells us. You know, in all things, it's not just money, it's your love, it's your time, it's your energy. You know, you want your relatives evangelized, evangelize somebody else's relatives. It's like that. Everything God does is like that. You know, you know they say you reap what you say, sow, the Bible says. You reap what you sow. If you reap to the flesh, you reap a whirlwind, the Bible says. If you sow to the Spirit, then you know you reap blessings from God in all areas. You know, I may go to the Philippines and see some Filipino pastor without shoes and clothes, and then I say, okay, Filipino pastor, you know, I'm going to buy you some shoes and clothes and use my own money and buy it for him and give to him. And then, you know, somebody's going to come evangelize one of my relatives and they're going to get saved. I mean, that's the way God works, brothers and sisters. If we honor him and bless and do his will, you know, he's going to put the blessings on us in all things, in all categories. It's not just one category. In all categories of our life, brothers and sisters. But the biggest problem that lots of people have is giving. You know, you're saying that, you know, A, money's your God, and you love more money more than you do God. Or B, you don't trust God. You think he's lying when he said that, you know, Jesus said out of his own mouth right here in Luke 6:38, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together, and running over shall men give unto your bosom. Men will give you. Men will give into your bosom. From with the same measure that ye meet without, it shall be measured back unto you again. And Jesus also talked about when you give, you know, you reap 30, 60, 100-fold. Jesus said that. It doesn't belong to the prosperity preachers. You know, have you ever took a, you know, just like a corn on the cob. If every grain or every little seed of corn you planted grew one seed of corn, what would be the point of planting it? Because it would be one seed for one seed. You know, only in God's system, evolution doesn't even make any sense. Only in God's system can I put one seed of corn in the ground, and then it grows a stalk with like 2 or 3 ears on it. You know, I used to do a garden with my dad when I was a kid, then I used to do a garden with my grandpa when I was grown. Before he died, he used to help my grandpa when he was too old to do his garden. My grandpa was a dairy farmer for many, many years, and then he retired from that, and I used to help him do a garden before until he died. And you know, it's really amazing that you can put one grain of corn in the ground and then you get like 3 ears. And then there's like, what is that? I don't know, 200 or 300 grains of corn on each ear. So you get like, what, 1,000 or whatever seeds for one you planted. Can you imagine that? That's the opposite of what evolution would tell you. You know, here's it increasing and growing up. You know, one apple seed, you plant an apple seed, then you get an apple tree. You know, and then on that tree, it produces fruit for what? 50 years? I don't know how long an apple tree lives. It produces how many apples, and every apple has how many seeds? Think about it. Think about it. It's crazy. You know, when you plant something, it produces more fruit. That's why Jesus said, brothers and sisters, in John, the Lord is just, you know, drawing this text to my attention. I believe it's John chapter 12, when the Greeks came to see the Lord. And then the Lord began to be troubled in his spirit, and he said, you know, God, Father, glorify your name. And then there was a thunder from heaven, and, you know, God said, I've glorified again. And Jesus said, a grain of wheat, unless it die and fall to the ground, it abideth alone. But if it dies and falls to the ground, you know, then it produces a harvest. So Jesus was talking about himself. He was getting ready to be crucified. You know, and so God had nobody in heaven. There was nobody in heaven because you could not enter the presence of God unless you were free from sin. The Old Testament sacrifices only covered our people's sins. It didn't remove people's sins. There was nobody in heaven with God until after Jesus. That's why he descended, after he died, he descended into the paradise, or Sheol, and he led captivity captive. He led them, you know, preached the gospel to them, to Abraham and all those guys in the bosom of Abraham. Then they ascended. And many of them were seen resurrected, walking around Jerusalem, it tells us in the last chapter of Matthew 28. It says that many of the Old Testament saints were seen walking around after the resurrection of Jesus. They were also resurrected on their way up to heaven. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so Jesus, you know, God wanted a family in heaven. So what did he do? He planted a seed, his own son, 3 days and three nights in the ground. And then it produced a harvest, a.k.a. the Old Testament saints were allowed to leave Sheol and go to heaven. Jesus led them there, led captivity captive. And then we, the church, we're allowed to enter behind the veil into the Holy of Holies, which represents heaven. We're allowed to enter heaven. Why? By the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, by the blood of the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world. We're allowed to enter into God's presence. So God's harvest is his church. So everything God does, and every way, is always a type and a shadow of things in heaven. Do things on earth out of the pattern I've showed you in heaven. Let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's why I've said in a video before, a man and a woman get married. People say, oh, you know, God has the church, you know, Jesus has a church as his bride, as a copy of, you know, like Adam and Eve, people get married. No. God made the plan of Adam and Eve getting married, and each of us getting married, after the pattern of Jesus in the church. Jesus was the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. People getting married is a shadow and a copy of Christ in the church. It's a copy of that. That's going to happen at the rapture. The bride of Christ with him. Having children. When we minister to people to get saved. God having children. We are God's children. When you're saved, it says in John chapter 1 that Jesus, when we believe on his name, Jesus gives us the power to become the children of God. So we become children of God. So the type of people having children, when you and when husband and wife create a child, this is a type of the same thing. It's a type of us being the children of God. Everything God does is in the same pattern, brothers and sisters. Even as the Bible told there, when God talked to Noah, he said that, you know, forever, for the rest of this age, which we're living in, this fallen age, there'll always be seed time and harvest. Everything is seed time and harvest. That goes for everything, brothers and sisters. So expand your natural mind to think in the spiritual way and think the way God thinks and see the way God sees, and you will see that everything God gave you is a seed. He gave you the ability to evangelize people. He gave you the ability to pray for people. He gave you the financial ability to give to other people to do it because you don't have time. There are people who are executives, business people, they're too busy. They donate to ministries who are doing it. Billy Graham, whomever the Lord leads you to donate to and give to, and then you're in the harvest with them. You know, they're out there evangelizing people and you're giving them the money to go there together. In the harvest, we are, brothers and sisters, whatever our calling is, intercessor, prayer warrior, evangelist, pastor, business people, all of the different things you can think of. Someone who mows the grass at their local church. Someone that goes and mows their old widow neighbor's yard and in the name of Jesus. They do it for the Lord. We're all together in the same team, brothers and sisters. That's what it's all about. God bless you guys. God bless you guys. I should give my testimony. I'll give a little bit about it before, but you can't outgive God. You know, the way I was able to go to the Philippines, I had no sponsors, no donations until Joshua's ministry, you know, that started in August 2012. Up until that year, 2012, I had the first donor that donated for the ministry in the year 2012. Before that, brothers and sisters, I was using all the money that the Lord gave me. And how did I get that money? Because I was doing tithes and offering. I was giving to the ministries that the Lord led me to, various ministries that the Lord led me to give to. You cannot give God. Everything I sowed, I reaped back 100-fold for the ministry, brothers and sisters. And I could go through all the whole story. But God has, I sowed and gave. I gave by faith into the kingdom of God for the work of God. And then God made a way for me to do the ministry in the Philippines. That's just how it works. That's how it works. Just like when I get saved, anything you do, you know, I know by faith I'm going to get saved. I know by faith you can receive healing. I know by faith you can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that prophesy according to your faith. I know that by faith God provides all things. And then God would use giving to show, hey, money's not my God. Here, money's not my God. This money I've got here, like say, you know, I've got $1,000. This money's not my God. The Lord's leading me to give, you know, $100 to 10 different ministries, whatever. Whatever the Lord tells me to do, that's what I'm going to do. Because I know God's going to provide. You know, next thing you know, God's going to make a way that I have $10,000 to do the ministry He gave me to do. I know that's how God works. Money's not my God. Property, you know, material possessions are not my God. God is my God. Nothing else, by the grace of God, nothing else is my God. And by His grace, may that always be true. Well, God would keep me in that place where those things are always true. And brothers and sisters, sometimes when I would preach boldly, people confuse bold preaching by the Spirit of God as some kind of arrogance. That's not true, brothers and sisters. That's not true. Boldness from the Spirit of God to proclaim the truth is different than being arrogant about yourself or about the flesh and all those kind of things. Totally different things. And if people ever do that to you, don't be moved by that nonsense. It's just the devil talking. Don't be confused by it. Don't be confused by it. When you're talking about Jesus, you can't be prideful when you're talking about Jesus and what He's done and what He does and what He's done. You can't be a prideful talking about the Lord and the gospel. God bless you guys. May the Lord bless you and keep you.